Good morning. I would like to welcome everyone to this, the ninth meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. I'd like to remind virtual members to place an R in the chat function on BlueJeans if they would like to come in on any issue. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. Do the committee agree to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private? Item 3 is for the committee to consider its next steps in relation to an inquiry into future parliamentary procedures and practices. Item 4 is for the committee to consider an amendment to the draft code of conduct rule changes. And item 5 is for members to consider some draft correspondence. Are the committee in agreement to take that privately? Agreed. I'm grateful. Agenda item 2, this is on committee substitutes. Our second item today is to consider the rules that relate to committee substitutes, which were varied in the period from the beginning of the pandemic until the dissolution of Parliament at the end of Session 5. The purpose of this was to provide more flexibility if committee members were unable to attend committees and to ensure that committee work was not adversely affected by the pandemic. The chair of the conveners group has written to the committee following a discussion on committee substitutes. In his letter, he has suggested the committee might wish to consider having two named substitutes rather than one. The current situation with regard to substitutes is covered in Rule 12.2A, Participation by Substitutes, and it says, where a committee member, A, is unavailable for a committee meeting or any committee activity taking place other than at a meeting because of illness, family circumstances, adverse travel conditions beyond the member's control, a requirement to attend other parliamentary business or urgent constituency business. And that's when a substitute can replace a member on the committee today. So, can I open it up to the committee for any comments? Bob, do you want to? Sorry.
Thanks, convener. I think committee members were looking at each other to see who was going to make a comment first. So I don't know if I get the short straw or not, convener. I suppose, first of all, I would thank the Deputy Presiding Officer and the conveners group for writing to us to raise this issue. I think it is important. Having previously sat on the conveners group, I know that you get a very well-considered and well-rounded view from conveners across of committees across the Parliament, and I think we have to take seriously their desire for continuity in committee membership, including substitutes. That said, I can see that they're trying to be helpful, and they absolutely acknowledge that during the pandemic, which is not quite over yet, sadly, that significant flexibility, in fact, complete flexibility, quite frankly, was absolutely required, and that flexibility continues just now, but at some point that does have to draw to a close or be formalised in a way which is more in keeping with the continuity that the conveners are seeking by having two named substitutes. So I think we should give serious consideration to that suggestion. I'd be very interested to know what the Parliamentary Bureau's thoughts are in relation to the conveners group suggestions, which I'm very open to, but also why they feel it potentially beneficial to have that open-ended flexibility embedded in parliamentary practices. I'm not so sure that is required, but of course it's the job of members in this committee to look at the evidence and to a well-considered, well-rounded view in relation to that, and perhaps we need just a wee bit more information before we can do that.
Thank you, Bob. That's helpful. Sue, would you like to comment?
Yes, thanks. I suppose, given that I'm here as a substitute, I think it's quite canny timing, shall we say. But I think, just reiterating what Mr Dorris has said there, I do think having that continuity and the consistency of your substitutes is key. And I would like to point out that this is obviously the Standards, Procedures and Public Affairs Committee, and I think Appointments Committee, rather. I think having that consistency on this committee is particularly relevant. So I think it may have to be scoped out in terms of some committees may have more flexibility than others, I think is certainly may be considered. But I've certainly found it helpful to have the consistency, and I hope that you might have found it helpful to have a consistent substitute being here as well.
Thank you, Sue. Absolutely. Your consistency in attendance has been incredibly helpful. Colette.
Thanks, Convener. From a subs perspective, and having been a sub on net zero, and it was excellent being on that. It was really good, especially with COP26. However, from a planning perspective, from a subs point of view, I'm obviously on this committee and also on criminal justice. However, if I was to then sub on a Tuesday, from a planning perspective as well, I think that would be challenging. So it's weighing that up in terms of, if it was going to be long-term again, subbing long-term, being on three committees, as well as trying to balance constituency work as well. You have to really weigh that up and have a really good conversation with your whip or your business manager as well. But equally as well, it would be good to get comment and feedback from the clerks on that in terms of how often are they used, the amount of work that the clerks put in, and having to actually scramble about trying to find a sub as well. So it'd be good to hear back from them as well. Thanks.
I think that's very helpful, Colette, because in the letter to this committee, it does state that no issues appear to have arisen as a consequence of the temporary, but we don't actually know what that is. So I seem to find an inclination towards an agreement to request the Bureau to provide their view, and perhaps if we request the clerks to look into how frequently substitutes have been used over this period of time, we'll be in a better position to make our suggestions. Sue?
In terms of the substitutions, when the clerks are reporting back to us, is it possible to know the reasons why the substitution was taking place without it? Obviously, so even if there's some, so we knew if it was health or COVID-related or constituency-related or something, just so that we could get some sort of sense as to where the challenges may lie. I understand that may not be possible for personal reasons.
I think that might be challenged. There are only, in essence, the reasons that are set out in Rule 12.2a. And I know that the way that is reached is usually with the discussion between the convener and the individuals. So I'm not sure that the reasons will be centrally held. It has to be one of those reasons for a substitute to be used. So I'd be confident that is the case, which may be useful. Sorry, Bob.
Sorry, Convener, just very briefly, I think Sue Webber raises a really interesting point in relation to illness and family requirements. There's, you'd expect, absolute confidentiality and privacy for the members, but some of the other reasons, I'm not suggesting we police it whatsoever, but some of the other reasons, such as require parliamentary business, could be open to interpretation, such as a ministerial visit in the constituency, for example, where some MSPs may deem that to be required parliamentary business, others may not, and it may be a grey area for some others. So it would just be quite helpful to know, the required parliamentary business aspect of it, whether that was particularly used. Not that we should police it, but just to get a feeling whether the flexibility has been used for fairly obvious and evident public health reasons due to the pandemic, or whether the flexibility has been used for other purposes, as they're entitled to be, but just to make sure we get a sense of the spread of reasons for why it's been used, with complete anonymity, of course, for the MSPs involved.
I think that's very helpful. So we'll ask for a slightly wider report from the clerks, going beyond just the statistics, but what other evidence is available as to when it's been used. Are we happy with that?
Yeah.
Good. I'm very grateful. Just before I close the public part of the committee, I would like to extend my thanks to Samantha Curry, who has served this committee as one of its clerks since 2012. And in that time, she has organised 287 committee meetings. She has published 124 committee reports. She has ensured compliance for over 300 cross-party groups, and published 24 revisions to standing orders. The clerks are an essential cog in the machine of the committees, and Sam has gone above and beyond over her time, and her knowledge of CPGs is possibly among the most detailed that sits within this Parliament. So on behalf of myself and indeed the whole committee, and indeed all previous members of the committees that you've worked with, can I say an enormous thank you, Sam, and wish you all the very best in the future. I would now like to close this public part of the meeting, and the committee will move into private.